So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome here at CEVRO. My task here is simple. I am just opening this special session, which is done in a cooperation with Forum 2000, and then we'll have to leave because I'm taking part at another discussion of the Forum 2000 right across the street, so you will remain in the hand of the Vice Dean of CEVRO College, Tomáš Pojar, who is more is qualified to do that. So I want to say just two things. First, as I said, we in CEVRO are launching a new cooperation with Forum 2000. It's for the first time when a part of the conference is being shifted also to this beautiful premises of our college, and we have the privilege to host Turkey Kurdish Minister Bakir on the discussion with on the future of the Kurdistan. And that makes me to my second point, Transatlantic Center of at the CEVRO Institute. One would expect that we are focusing just on European and American affairs, as we did in the last two major events, which we have here in September. But we are trying to make wider our range because simply the current world is a global, and the various hotspots attract and have to attract the attention of the Euro-American civilization, both in the bad as well as good sense. And the development in Kurdistan, including the active assistance which was provided by the Czech government. I am very critical about the Czech government, but this is something what I applaud the Czech government. It's a confirmation how we are all interconnected. And you see on the screen in background that Kurdistan is not the only issue which we are planning to discuss here at CEVRO with the Transatlantic Center. The another discussion is coming soon on October 23rd. We will focus on the global jihad. That's the product of the cooperation which Tomáš has helped to establish with the Herzliya Institute in Israel. So we will have more than qualified participants and speakers also from Israel. So feel free to be invited as well. And then just to make a preliminary announcement that in the middle of November, of course, it will be crowded with the various discussion marking the 25th anniversary of the Velvet Revolutions in the region, but we will enrich this with some entirely different, and that's a debate on the future of Korea, because it looks like as another hotspot, in particular with the possible development in Northern Korea. So, once again, welcome here at CEVRO, and please, the floor is yours. Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you very much for opening remarks. I will just go directly to the topic, as I also welcome you here, and I'm glad that it's a full house. So it also says something about the importance of the topic, as, which is these days quite a lot in the news, be it the Kurdish regional government and the part of Iraq, which Minister Falah Mustafa Bakir is representing, but also there are some other developments in the area regarding the Kurdish population, and of course not only. As we've heard on the daily basis now, the fighting and the struggle is in the Kobani, in the town of Kobani and the Kobani district, where there are conflicting reports and changing reports of the offensives and counter-offensives. The good news is some good news from today, when the Kurdish, local Kurdish, Syrian Kurdish forces have recaptured some ground, but definitely that fight is not over and it will continue. Today, after months of quiet from 2013, there was the first bombardment of the Turkish Air Force on its Turkish-owned territory, bombing the PKK outposts on the skirmishes on the border with Syria. You've heard about the casualties inside Turkey, you've heard about the casualties in Germany and on the European soil, dealing with the unrest and the spillovers of the situation. And, and there are debates of the involvement of the NATO member states and others in fighting Islamic State on behalf of the Kurdish forces, on behalf of other forces on the ground. So this is the topic which we will be discussing also next Thursday, dealing with the Islamic State as such. And besides the two Israeli speakers who have a profound knowledge of the counterinsurgency and the counterterrorism fights in the region, as one of them has been traveling in the areas of Syria, Turkey, and Kurdistan or Iraqi Kurdistan recently. But there will be also a Czech flavor that General Kovanda, who has been our former who has been the head of the military intelligence, but prior to that, the head of the special forces in the counterinsurgency efforts in Afghanistan will be talking about the parallels and possibilities based on the knowledge and lessons learned from Afghanistan, and seeing what can be done, what can work out, and what will not work out in Iraq, Syria, in the battleground with the Islamic State or Daesh, if you want. I will first invite the two speakers to the podium here to have 20 minutes of their speech lecture as comments on the present day situation. But then, of course, we will take questions and answers, questions from the audience, comments from the audience, and we will try to answer that, and I hope it's going to be a lively debate. So let me introduce Minister Falah Mustafa Bakir, who has been representing here the Kurdish regional government during the Forum 2000 conference and here at the CEVRO. He's had a distinguished career inside the Kurdish regional government's authorities, dealing not only with the foreign affairs issues as recently, but also with domestic issues in the past. And I think we don't have here in Czech Republic or possibly in Central Europe these days anyone more qualified to give a first-hand testimony of the situation and the views on where the situation, how it can develop, and what we may be facing in the future, and what the people on the ground may be facing in the future. We will be screening two maps. Those will be the maps for the audience to see the complex situation on the ground. Those are not the maps which would be prejudging any solutions and setups of any new borders once the system of the Sykes-Picot lines and borders is crumbling all over the Middle East after 100 years of existence. But the first map will be about the Kurdish population exactly in different countries and parts of the region. The other will be a mosaic of ethnic, religious complexities of the whole region. So I hope that it will also show to everyone that you can more explicitly see what we are talking about. Mr. Minister, thank you very much for joining us, and the floor is yours.
Oops. Well, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, it's my pleasure and privilege to be here at this distinguished institute in order to represent the voice of Kurdistan, region of Iraq, who have suffered from isolation and negligence for many parts of our history. Today, the Middle East is at crossroads, and increasingly the Kurds are becoming an important player in the politics of the Middle East. In the past, we were isolated in our mountains, telling the whole world that we have no friends but the mountains. But today, that equation has changed, and we are pleased and proud to say that we have many friends in many countries around the world, and Czech Republic has proven to be one with which that we have enjoyed historical ties when the late General Mustafa Barzani has visited this country a long time ago. So we want to redevelop and re-strengthen the relationship with the Czech Republic. Indeed, in the past, our voice was not heard. But today, we want to make sure that we are everywhere and we don't feel shy to be everywhere, because the politics of the Middle East requires that. We want to be a player among the other players in the region. We are not underestimating others, but we want to be present with the others. To talk about the future of Kurdistan, it requires that we talk about the past. Why do we want to have a better future? Because as simply I can say that we did not enjoy a better past. That's why we want to ensure the future for our generations to come would be better than what I have seen and others before me had seen it. I will go to 1991, when, as a result of the Gulf War, the first Gulf War, the invasion of Kuwait by Iraq, where there was an opportunity for the people in Iraq to decide and determine another future. Therefore, there were two uprisings, one in the southern part of Iraq by the Shias, another one by the Kurds in the Kurdistan region. Ours succeeded. The one in the south did not succeed that much because there were reasons for it. There was not proper leadership, there was not organization, and there was not clear vision. And there was interference as well. While the Kurdish uprising succeeded because we had Kurdistan Front, that was the umbrella organization of 8 political parties. There was leadership, there was organization, there was commitment, and also a clear objective that we wanted to have a better future for our people. So the first thing we did was that we have benefited from the no-fly zone. That was the first time that there was something international. Although it was a kind of after-sale service, because when the international community decided to interfere in Kuwait and oust Saddam Hussein troops, as a result of that, there was the uprising. Then they allowed Iraqi troops to use helicopters and machine guns, and then this is where they were able to crush the uprising in the south and also come towards Kurdistan. When there was a mass exodus, millions of people were fleeing towards the Iranian and Turkish borders. But it was viewed as a humanitarian problem and not as a political problem. So as a result of that, the operation Provide Comfort was provided and a no-fly zone was established. As a result of the aerial protection that was provided for the people of Kurdistan, we were able to start our journey towards building democratic institutions. The first thing we did was to call for elections in 1992. We started the journey by electing our parliament, and the parliament in Kurdistan at the time decided to opt for a federal solution within Iraq. Even then, when we were free from Saddam Hussein's control, we thought that a federal structure would serve our interests and also Iraq's interest in creating and ensuring a better future. But it was not easy for us to survive and work in an area that we are surrounded by countries who did not wish success for our experience. And I will say it explicitly, because Kurds are there in Turkey, in Iran, and in Syria. So these three countries, in addition to Saddam Hussein, none of them wanted the Kurdish experience to succeed, but it succeeded, because we were determined to make it a successful one. Thanks to our people, to their dedication, and to their commitment to support the leadership. I remember very well when Tariq Aziz was saying that the Kurdish people, because when they withdrew their troops and their forces in the region, they said that the Kurdish people will throw the Kurdish leadership out, and Kurdish people would come and beg us and will kiss our hands. This was his words. For Baghdad to come back and control, it did not happen. We faced challenges, economic challenges, security challenges, political challenges, but still we did it. We were not able to pay the salaries of civil servants and teachers for 6 months. People were ready to go and sell their own belongings, but not surrender to the will of Saddam Hussein. The oil for food was the first time that we were able to benefit from the revenues of oil in a country that's oil rich. And originally, Iraq relied on the oil from Kirkuk, which is a city with Kurdish identity, part of Iraq. So until then, the revenues of oil were used to buy weapons to destroy Kurdistan. So we have 4,500 of villages of Kurdistan were destroyed. 182,000 people disappeared in the notorious Anfal operations. Anfal is a name of a verse in Quran when Muslims fight infidels. And this was something that was publicly published by the regime during their operations in Kurdistan. And they called it, this was a development project for Kurdistan. We had 8,000 Barzani men, 12,000 Feili Kurds who disappeared, and the chemical gassing and bombing of Halabja. This was our history, but we have never allowed that to create a tension between Kurdish people and Arab people of Iraq, because we blame the regime for the crimes, not the people. Therefore, we are proud of that culture of tolerance, and we did not hold the people of Iraq responsible for the crimes of the regime. And thanks to our leadership, we were able to educate our people that we have to live in peace, because the Middle East already had the Arab-Israeli conflict. It cannot afford having another problem like that. But it was not an easy march. With having all these difficulties and challenges, we don't have access to the sea. Therefore, travel into and out of the region should have been through one of these countries, either through Turkey, through Iran, or Syria. One was more difficult than the other. So, therefore, keeping a region safe and secure and trying to develop a region, having no budget, having no access to the sea, was not an easy thing. But since we were determined, we were able to make it. 9/11 has changed the world and world's attitude towards our region. In April 2002, when we knew from the Americans that they had the intention to topple the regime in Iraq and bring about the change, we joined that effort and we offered to do whatever we can to help change the regime, because we had a stake in that and we wanted to have a better future. Therefore, we believe that by toppling Saddam Hussein regime, not only the Kurds, but other Iraqis would have a better opportunity for having a prosperous and a better future. Therefore, in 2003, the Kurdish leadership decided to go back to Baghdad. Although if we compare the area between the period between 91 to 2003, we were almost independent. We had no relationship with Baghdad. Indeed, even the economy was different, because the money, the Iraqi dinars, which were in circulation in Kurdistan region, were different from the one that were used by Saddam Hussein controlled area. The purchasing power of that was even in Kurdistan region was better than the rest of Iraq, because the economy was doing better. But we wanted to be part of an Iraq that's stable, secure, free, inclusive, federal, pluralistic, and democratic. And this was our expectation, because we believe that we have partners in the rest of the country who would agree on the same approach. Therefore, we worked hard for the constitution of the country in order to have a constitution which ensures these rights, which sets in concrete the rights of the components of the Iraqi society, the Arabs, the Kurds, the Turkmen, the Chaldean, Assyrian, Muslims, and non-Muslims. We fought for these rights, and we believed in them, but we wanted them to succeed and to work. Unfortunately, it did not work. We have waited enough. I'm talking to you in 2014, but we started the journey in 2003. Comparing what Kurdistan did alone from 91 to 2003 is far more better than what Iraq as a whole did from 2003 until 2014. Where does the problem lie? The problem lies in their commitment to sharing the power, sharing the wealth, and accepting and respecting others. So therefore, it has not been an easy thing. We have problems over power control. Baghdad wants to control the destiny of everyone in Iraq, and all decisions to be made in Baghdad without respect to the other components and other people who live in the country. As a result of that, we have seen the violence, which somebody call it civil war, somebody call it a sectarian war, somebody call it a Shia-Sunni power struggle. No matter what we call it, it was a violence and it was an unsafe and insecure situation. We as Kurds, we were not part of the sectarian struggle, but we were part of the political dispute and differences. The sectarian power struggle is something between the Shias and Sunnis. We are not part of that. But when it comes to the political disagreements and political conflict, yes, we are part of it because we would be affected in one way or another by any kind of political disagreement. Therefore, we continued in Kurdistan region with the beliefs and with the values that we believed in. Values of freedom, democracy, tolerance, peaceful coexistence, the empowerment of women, and making sure that democracy that we have started the journey continues and flourishes. Next to that, we embarked upon an ambitious economic development program by opening and adopting a free market-oriented approach, inviting and encouraging foreign direct investment into Kurdistan region, and also encouraging the outside world to have presence in Kurdistan. Those countries who have had diplomatic representation in Iraq and embassies in Baghdad, we encourage them to open consulates or embassy office or even liaison office. And I have to admit that the Czech Republic was the first country to open its liaison office in Erbil, the capital of Kurdistan region. Throughout these years, Kurdistan proved to be safe and secure, to be welcoming and friendly, and to open the door to deal with all the other players in the Middle East. In fact, we have a problem because we live in the Middle East, we live as part of Iraq. Iraq is a founding member of the League of Arab States, but most of the Arab countries did not understand us, or they have followed the ideology or the policies of the central government at the time. Some countries were not ready to open the door in our face. Some countries did not like us out of nothing, no reason. Therefore, we opened the door and we have been calling for the Arab-Kurdish dialogue. We have invited some Arab intellectuals, politicians, writers to come to the Kurdistan region so that we understand each other. We also have been focusing on strengthening ties with Egypt. We have also had at Markaz Ibn Khaldun, the Ibn Khaldun Center, Kurdish-Arab dialogue once there, because we wanted to address the Arab elite, the Arab intellectuals, to talk about where do we stand? What do we mean when we talk about our future? What do we mean when we talk about Iraq? Therefore, we saw the importance of the depth of strategic relations with the Arab countries so that they understand our ambitions, they understand where do we stand on these issues. On the other hand, we had to enjoy good relations with our neighbors, which is an important issue for us. Turkey and Iran are both neighbors that we share long borders with. In addition to that, we have large Kurdish populations both in Turkey, Iran, and Syria. So therefore, it's very important for us to enjoy good relations with them, but at the same time, we support the rights of the Kurdish people in each of these parts. But we made it clear that when we talk about our future, we talk about Iraqi Kurdistan. When we talk about the rights of our brothers and sisters in Turkey, Iran, and Syria, would be for the Kurdish people in these countries to reach agreements in peaceful ways with the government of the countries that they live with. So we have always been very clear in our policies. We have never been ambiguous, and we have never had any disagreements with this principle, because we believe that we have to be realistic. Yes, it's the same nation, but we have been divided. The reality is on the ground that we have become parts of four countries. We started the journey by focusing on rebuilding our infrastructure. Even today, the infrastructure in Kurdistan needs worth of $32 billion in order to be able to be at proper standards, because it was totally neglected during the era of Saddam Hussein regime. And so far, even this year, we have not received our budget from the federal government in Baghdad. So therefore, this is one of the major tasks. But we are determined to build a proper infrastructure for the future of the region. In terms of political progress, we have made progress. And we are proud of the political maturity that we have developed. Today, we have a coalition government that several political parties with different approaches are part of this coalition government, and they are working together for a better future. Working with Baghdad, after trying 8 years of former Prime Minister Maliki's government, we realized that there was no way for us to make any progress. Therefore, we had made it clear that either we will see a meaningful change in Baghdad, or we cannot continue the same way. The same way, it means that we have ended up with a failed state, a dysfunctional government. We don't want to repeat the same mistakes of the past. So after the elections earlier this year, we decided to join the government, although not a single political party in Kurdistan region was in favor of joining the government. But because of the necessity, first, facing the challenge of the terrorists of ISIS, second, the economic hardship of having 1.5 million refugees and IDPs in Kurdistan region, and the fact that we are suffering from economic and financial problems, we wanted to join to give an opportunity for the new cabinet in Baghdad so that we start again looking at the disagreements and the differences that we have. One of the disagreements that we have on the oil or the energy sector. The constitution of Iraq is very clear that it gives the right of managing the oil to Kurdistan Regional Government. We believe in the constitutional framework, which says that oil and gas belong to all the people of Iraq in all the regions and governorates, and the revenues should be distributed evenly among the Iraqi people. We have no objection in that, and we are committed. Baghdad does not accept this principle. What Baghdad wants is to control it, all the revenue to go to Baghdad, and again for us to be at the mercy of Baghdad, just like what happened this year, not to send our budget. And we say no control. We share it, we manage it, we produce it. And indeed, our policy has succeeded because we have followed the standard of production sharing contracts while Baghdad opted for technical service contracts. We were able to produce and to develop this sector out of scratch, starting from scratch and having not developed anything in the past, while Baghdad, instead of improving and increasing their production, they have decreased the production. So therefore, we are ready for talking to the new Iraqi cabinet and the new oil minister in order to reach an agreement on this. Another area of disagreement is the issue of the Peshmerga, of the status of the Peshmerga. According to the constitution of Iraq, Peshmerga are the regional guards and they are a constitutional force. And in accordance with that constitution, they should have been paid, equipped, trained, and armed. They have not been neither paid, nor armed, nor trained, nor equipped. So therefore, the Peshmergas continued with their old, outdated Russian weaponry that we had captured from the Iraqi army in the wars of the 80s and the uprising of 1991 and 2003. While we are facing the threat of ISIS, who are using the most sophisticated and advanced weapons that they have captured from the Iraqi army, which were provided by the Americans. So therefore, the status of the Peshmerga is an important point to be clarified. The other one is about Kirkuk and other disputed areas, areas which were covered by Article 140. What we have been asking for is to draw the boundaries of Kurdistan region. For any government, for any institution, it's important, even at the individual case, somebody has to know where his fence of the house is. But they have not allowed this constitutional article to be implemented. It's a very easy process. It's a three-stage process by normalization of the situation, by conducting a census, and then a referendum. The Kurdish leadership did not want to impose a solution on that. We said the people of Kirkuk will determine their own future, whether they want to be part of Kurdistan or part of the rest of Iraq. Because even if it were to be decided part of Kurdistan region is part of Iraq. Therefore, for us, it was clear in our mind, it would not make a difference, but it's important for people to be given that right. Unfortunately, it did not happen. Therefore, the talking about the future of Kurdistan, where to go from here. We have got the disagreements with Baghdad over the budget, oil, Peshmerga, status of Kirkuk. But most importantly, we have the issue of the system of governance in Baghdad, which is an Iraq-wide problem, not only a problem for the Kurds, because even the Sunni component in Iraq, they felt marginalized, excluded, and not participants in the running of the country. So either we are to be committed to this constitution that the majority of the Iraqi people voted for, or we have to find a different way of coexistence. With the challenges that we face, and with the reality that we see on the ground today, we have Kurdistan region in the north, we have the Sunnis in the western part of Iraq, in Mosul, in Salah ad-Din, parts of Diyala and Anbar province, which unfortunately now most of it is under the control of ISIS, then Baghdad and the southern part under the control of Shia. Some people want to deny this reality, but by denying the reality, we cannot help solving it. This is the picture on the ground. Going back to the elections, this year's election, the last election, the one before, Shias voted for Shia parties, Sunnis for Sunni party, Kurds for Kurds. Mr. Ambassador, you were there. I'm sure you have witnessed the elections. It is a reality. Until trust is built, we cannot claim that there would be Kurds voting for Shia parties or Shias voting for Kurdish parties. It's a reality. But we can live together based on that constitution to have a federal system. A federal system not necessarily symmetrical. It could be asymmetrical federation. The powers that the Kurds have may be different from the powers that the Sunnis have or the Shias have. But we have to reach an agreement to respect each other, to understand each other, and to live with each other. That would be the thing. But having said that, what future do we have now? The possibilities are limited. One, to have this current situation to continue, Baghdad to be continuing like this, dysfunctional, insecure, the western part to be under the control of ISIS, and we in Kurdistan to continue to struggle with fighting ISIS and caring for the 1.5 million refugees and IDPs who are in Kurdistan, or for the leadership in Iraq to reach an agreement to implement the constitution which could ensure that there would be either a proper federal system, a meaningful federal system, whereby power is determined by the constitutional principles, or a kind of a confederation of three sovereign states within the boundaries of Iraq. These are all options among the Iraqi leadership. The Kurdish leadership has talked to the Iraqi leadership that we have between now and the end of the year to find a proper situation. But dealing with ISIS, We believe that the airstrikes have been effective, and we're grateful to the Americans that they have interfered at the right time. With the airstrikes, they were able to help the Peshmergas, who are a reliable partner on the ground, in order to change the equation. While around 7th and 8th of August, ISIS was close to Erbil. Now ISIS is, we are close to Mosul. So we have pushed them back, and we have proven to the whole world that ISIS could be defeated, and ISIS is defeatable. So therefore, if we can work together for the rest of Iraq, we will be able to do it. But who are the partners on the ground? Where is the Iraqi army? Have we left up with the Iraqi army? Because we know for sure 10 divisions of the Iraqi army have collapsed. 6 in our region, 4 in the Anbar and Baghdad provinces. We have got some militia, Shia militia groups in Baghdad. And we have got the Sunni tribes. Therefore, it's a responsibility with the new government to be inclusive, representative, but to pave the way for a meaningful participation for all the components so that they play a role in helping defeat ISIS militarily. If the question is whether ISIS could be defeated in all of Iraq, yes, it's doable, but it needs reliable partners, Shias, Sunnis, or Iraqi units to work together. We are ready to work with them. Mosul is important to be cleaned up from the terrorists, to be liberated from the terrorists. But we will not do it alone. We need partners. But in order for us also to sustain this war, we need heavy weaponry. Because we cannot, yes, we are thankful for the weapons that we have received, for the ammunition that we have received, but it has been small arms, limited ammunition, and light weaponry, some medium level. But we need real heavy weaponry in order to fight ISIS, because they have advanced and heavy weaponry. So this is one of the points. Second, the issue of the political system. Talking about the Sunnis to feel that they are partners and they have a responsibility and they have rights. When they are represented in Baghdad, there are people who talk about a region for the Sunnis. We in Kurdistan, we encourage that. Because at least this would be one way of ensuring that they have a voice, that they have presence, and they can take care of the needs of their own community, and then be present in Baghdad strongly so that they can be participating in the decision-making process. Because when the Kurds and the Sunnis are there strongly, we can make sure that the Shias would listen to us and we work together. But the absence of one group in Baghdad would make the equation unstable. So by saying that, it's not a difficult task, it's doable, but it needs political will from the partners in Baghdad to say it. I will end by talking about independence Kurdistan, or the independence for Kurdistan. There is a lot of talk about this, as if this is something taboo or we should not talk about it. Well, if we are not able to find the right solution in Iraq, then what would be the choice for the Kurds? Recently, President Barzani was very clear when he talked about a dual path approach. A path being engaged heavily in Baghdad, helping the political process, finding solutions for the problems, being real partners. If we are not able to reach there, the only way would be for the leadership in Kurdistan to go back to the people through a referendum, for the people of Kurdistan to exercise the right to self-determination. So whatever right they would exercise or whatever issue they would decide upon, then the Kurdish leadership would be obliged to listen to and to implement it. But whichever way that ends, be it a federation, confederation, or independence, we still want to have good relations with the rest of Iraq, because we have suffered a lot and we have seen a lot of insecurity and instability. Therefore, we want to make sure that we live in peace with our neighbors, with our partners, with other nations around us. Therefore, for us, we have no ambiguity in our vision. Our first choice and our priority is to reach an agreement with Baghdad on solving our problems and be a successful federal system. But if our partners in Baghdad don't help us reach there, then we would be left with no other choice to go to the people of Kurdistan and decide in a referendum. And thank you.
Mr. Minister, thank you very much. Before I pass the floor to Sergei Danilochkin, in order not to forget, I must thank the NATO Information Center, which has spread the news about this event and has been promoting this event, so many thanks to them. And I also want to recognize a few people in the audience, General Voznica, who was our long-term ambassador in Baghdad, in Iraq, also covering Kurdish regional government and being instrumental in pushing forward opening of our Czech office in Erbil. Of course, Senator Bublan, our former head of intelligence and minister of interior. There is another former minister of interior standing in the back. But what is most important now is that Senator Bublan is the head of the Senate's Defense, Security and Foreign Affairs Committee. Last but not least, I must recognize Amr Moussa, who has been the long-term Foreign Minister of Egypt, Ambassador for Egypt, and Secretary General of Arab League. So we are pleased to have you here. Sergei Danilochkin was born in Moscow, is a journalist, but recently has been heading and is director of the Radio Free Europe's Radio Liberty's Iraq section, or Radio Free Iraq. He has a distinguished career as a journalist, but he is the one who knows a lot about Iraq itself, about the situation in Erbil and in the whole region. So we thank you very much for coming, and we welcome your perspective on the situation on the ground and on what we can expect in the near future, in coming days and weeks, but let's say what we can expect also in next years, or what will be the Kurdistan or the Middle East in 2025.
Thank you for the introduction. Dear guests, thank you for having me here. It's very difficult and easy to speak after the previous speaker here. Difficult because, as opposed to him, I'm not a practical politician or practical statesman, so I do not have the will to steer. I rather have a pen to write. Easy because he already started setting up the the discussion here, and I do not have a written presentation because I wanted just to briefly stop at a few points that we have covering daily and that we come across. It is an issue of our focus, professional focus at Radio Free Iraq. But it's also probably going to be interesting to raise those issues in the course of this discussion. Maybe at some points I will raise some questions which will, again, I'm not in a position to be the devil's advocate, but just maybe to make the discussion livelier and less formal and less strict. First of all, of course, the topic of our meeting today is the future of Kurdistan. If we all had a crystal ball, we could clearly say that in 10, 15 years, Kurdistan is going to be this or that. But unfortunately, Kurdistan is located in such a difficult part of the world, and the history of that area is so complex and complicated that it's very difficult to predict with even 50% certainty, I believe. Although we have positive hopes, but the views on the future are from pessimistically unrealistic to optimistically unrealistic through various shades of realistic approaches, because some people believe that the bright future will happen almost tomorrow, and some people think that just the disaster is coming and is knocking on our door already today. But there are some people who, despite all those feelings, keep working and look for viable solution. And this is the most difficult, because this is such a fluid period, and the area is getting more and more complex with new challenges. And the most recent of it is the ISIS or ISIL that completely, I think, redrawn all the political, economic, and social plans, not only for Iraq, Kurdistan, Syria, Turkey, but for many countries that are way further away from that area. And the more we keep digging into that organization or grouping, the more information we get about it, the more concerns we get for the area and beyond that. The thing that I also wanted to point out is that quite recently, after the elections that you referred to, the situation was developing in a quite familiar, I would say, scenario, of course, specifically different in this part, but very much resembling the situation of 2005, when there was, pardon me for this sort of straightforwardness, we saw a nearly paralysis of Iraqi political system, because the parties that exist were not able to come to an agreement, and everyone was having demands and was hoping to achieve something through negotiating and concessions from other parties. And this is the way the Iraqi politics has been developing in the past few years. However, I think the important part was that whereas in 2003 the Kurds as an ethnic entity was seen as a very close ally of the Iraqi Shia religious entity. Right now, we came to see that the two groups came at certain odds, and this is a very important moment. It could drive the situation into complications, or it could become a first step in a really, as you said, pluralistic and a really democratic society. Because everyone, I think, or the majority of observers who were observing the elections and the results were unhappy about the same trend that people were voting by their sect or by their group. They were not looking at political parties, they were rather looking at their group leaders and supporting charismatic or not so charismatic leaders rather than certain issues, certain programs. If this continues, this is of course going to bring more complications to the situation in Iraq, and of course to Kurdistan or by Kurdistan here I mean the Iraqi Kurdistan as part of Iraq. And this brings me to a short list of challenges that I will try to outline here. First of all, of course, the regional politics and the regional challenges that exist. History, of which we have heard and we know about, but also current reality. As Kurdistan was about, or making steps, and there were statements made within Kurdistan that brought to fear those who are afraid of independent Kurdistan, and a lot of observers were expecting this to happen in the past few months. The current sort of politics or the current situation has changed it a little bit. It was corrected in some way. But still, the issue of Kurdistan's independence is, I think, creates troubles for many politicians in the area, not only for the Iraqi politicians, of course, who hate to see this prosperous region of their country gone, but also other political elites who are concerned about their own prosperity. And we know that major regional players are trying to work with the situation for their own benefit. Because, of course, everyone wants a peaceful neighbor, but on the other hand, one neighbor less creates less problems for those people. Because, as you said, that the Kurdish nation is the ethnic group is spread out in this area, and we know that for centuries, if we can judge from historical books, the Kurds were looking at their own home and statehood. This creates certain problems with the past and current politics. The other issue, I think, is security. And the spring of this new group, and I mean ISIS, has indicated that security challenges might come virtually unnoticed. I mean, for the people who've been watching the developments, I think the transition of Al-Qaeda and its subsidiaries into ISIS, and of course Al-Qaeda still remains a major challenge for the area and beyond, but ISIL now becomes even a more stronger challenge for everyone there because of its ruthlessness and because of straightforward actions and, you know, sort of thirst for power and dominance. This, however, indicates that such kind of collisions that might happen may impact the whole situation. And as we see, the threat was very sizable and very, I'd say, realistic. When at certain days in August, people were scared that, you know, just in a matter of hours, the fighters of ISIL will be at the doorsteps of Erbil, and there was a certain panic even among the Iraqi military command, who withdrew so swiftly from Mosul to Erbil and further, that indicated that you know, the news about it or the rumors about it indicated that, you know, something is really nasty is going to happen. And everyone was scared and everyone was afraid. And I think that a lot of people are scared and afraid now, but as you mentioned, that the recent fights indicate that, you know, there is a solution, and maybe we will see the situation slowly turning and the tide slowly turning backwards. However, it is a factor that right now I think dominates the whole equation in Iraq and around Iraq. Now, the also one more challenge for Kurdistan is its economy. Right now, Kurdistan is a very prosperous area within Iraq and in the area, very fast developing, undeniably, very attractive. However, if we're talking about possible partition of Iraq and Kurdistan becoming an independent independent nation, I wonder how the investors and business community would look at Kurdistan having a economic border with Iraq. Is it going to be as attractive as it is now? This is a question, right? And so, of course, it's not a threat, but I'm sure that everyone who are concerned with real political development and real changes in the area should look into that, because this is a serious factor. And as we know, we heard that there needs to be a huge investment in the basics of Kurdistan's economy. This is a factor that should not be discounted. Then I would also want to draw attention to the factors of internal politics and social development. Although we've seen that Kurdistan has been developing rather peacefully compared to what is happening in the rest of Iraq. However, some of the civil society activists are pointing at certain problems there. First of all, every critic of the situation in Kurdistan points at the traditional dominance of two major parties, which has been challenged recently, especially during the latest elections, when one of the parties had to yield some influence to as a result of those elections to the opposition. Which is, I think, an optimistic development. It shows that, you know, this transition or this sort of that the situation in Kurdistan is not frozen, and the transition is actually happening in a pretty, you know, clearly democratic way. However, things like human rights are still raising, you know, concerns. This goes hand in hand with the political development, and also I want to sort of raise an issue of Islamic or Islamist influence that is raising in Kurdistan in the past few years. And as we know, it proclaimed itself in hopefully few incidents when we learned that the Kurdish young people were subdued by the propaganda and sort of luring actions of the ISIL to go on the other side of the border, take up arms and start fighting with their own kin and with others who are in the position of being attacked. I understand that this is a challenge for security forces in Kurdistan, for the politicians. However, this growing Islamist sort of discourse, popularity probably or importance that it receives in that part of the world, and I don't mean Kurdistan in particular, but if we are speaking about Kurdistan, then it's also part of the equation there. Should be very much sort of practically looked at. Over here, I do not mean that it should be sort of countered, but it should really be looked at and embraced in a way that will allow non-violent development of the situation. I would also like to switch to some points that you've mentioned that represent some challenges in the relationship between Baghdad and Erbil, and that make Erbil very sour because Erbil doesn't get what they believe is their right. On the other hand, Baghdad thinks probably that, you know, just it gives too much. And these five issues which you mentioned are oil, budget, security forces, Article 140, and the general governance of the country. On the issue of the budget, I believe that we are talking now a day before it should be. I mean, the draft law should be finally introduced in the Iraqi parliament, together with the draft budget of the next year. Hopefully, something should be done. But I believe that what we heard from Iraqi colleagues elsewhere in outside of Kurdistan, they are also suffering from lack of budget resources coming into them, because generally speaking, the whole budget situation in Iraq has been at a standstill. I understand that for the Kurdish government, it's for Kurdistan's government, it's a specific concern, but over there, just playing a role of the devil's advocate, I want to say that, you know, just the budget is an issue for the whole country. The oil is also something that is part of those seven or eight or nine packages that Baghdad and Erbil has been negotiating over since probably 2003, maybe even. Of course, even before, but, you know, just we're talking about the modern history. Still, it is not resolved, I understand that for the Kurdistan for the authorities of Kurdistan who are planning for a certain development of their area, and they're looking and they're saying, okay, let's plan our lives. We are in control of this territory. Let's try to develop here. Right? Maybe we will set an example for the rest. And this is clear why there is so much importance that the KRG is investing into this particular point of the agenda. I think that the Iraqi authorities would probably love to resolve this issue. However, we know that the oil resources are spread around the country unequally. And here comes Article 140 with Kirkuk and its oil deposits there. So right now, I think the Baghdad politicians are looking at this very cautiously because they are looking at the equation. You know, if we let it go, then what happens to our budget? And the issue of Peshmerga, I think. Here's something that is an indicator of a mutual distrust. You mentioned that in your speech here, that both Iraqi Arab politicians and Kurdish politicians, and within each of the communities, there is a lot of mistrust towards the natural partners. I mean, all the politicians who are acting on the Iraqi political scene are, whether they want it or not, are have to be partners. But they don't trust each other. And the issue of Peshmerga is probably one of the most notorious of those issues of mistrust. I remember we were reporting on situations when violence was taking place in those areas that are contested under the provisions of Article 140, and there were Kurdish units that were located there, and Baghdad was giving them orders to do something about, you know, the violent elements. However, the commanders on the ground said, well, we have to receive our orders from Erbil. I probably it was very difficult for the then prime minister and commander-in-chief to realize that he is not the one who directly runs the Peshmerga here. However, I understand the issue. We had some conversations with our good friend General Jabar Yawar, who explained to us this equation of budgeting, training, supplying, and all that stuff. But however, this for the outsiders, it indicates that no, there is not much trust. The Kurdish authorities are afraid of the past of Iraq, where Baghdad forces invaded and attacked the Kurdish population. And Baghdad, on the other hand, understanding that Peshmerga is one of the most, and as proven lately, or recently, that Peshmerga is one of the most battle-capable part of security for apparatus that is on the ground in Iraq. They were, scared that this might be turned against them. They were not ready, probably, to accept responsibility and maybe do a risky step to extend their hand a little bit further than they thought would equally be all right. The issue of heavy weapons is also probably falling into this basket, because both sides are watching each other receiving supplies of weapons lately, and of course both are thinking if things go wrong, whether these weapons are going to be used against us or not. That is why they are looking into some sort of a parity or trying to block such kind of imparity. So this I think is an indicator that the mistrust needs to be addressed. and it should be addressed on both sides. One of the manifestations of the situation is that as far as we're concerned, we are broadcasting in Arabic and into Iraq and into Kurdistan, and we have a very loyal audience. Unfortunately, we noticed that in some parts of the country, the audience becomes different from the natural sort of mix of population. Our listeners are becoming older. Partially, it happens in Kurdistan, where we heard that, you know, the younger generation does not want to listen to the news in Arabic. They prefer to do it in Kurdish, and actually, they are better equipped to do that in their own language rather than Arabic, because under the previous regime, whether they wanted or not, if they wanted to be successful, they had to go through the Iraqi system of education, which was in Arabic language. And you know it because you were part of that. However, right now, Kurdistan receiving the tool of autonomy and exercising its rights, changed the system of education into Kurdish language. To the unfortunately, sort of that hurts the capacity of the young Kurdish people to communicate with their colleagues elsewhere in Iraq. So this is just one example that I think is also needs to be addressed. And if that is addressed, the issue of mistrust, not only between the politicians, but between ordinary people, will be resolved in a way. Also, I just wanted to put here slightly debatable point. We were discussing it with the colleagues today, the issue of Kurdistan's possible independence and how the regional actors might react to it. And of course, everyone is pointing at various factors that might impact the influence, especially that traditionally the neighbors, the neighbors of Iraq in that area, who share Kurdish population, were afraid that a similar secession might happen there, in one way or another. So they're, you know, watching this process very, very closely. However, one of the colleagues pointed out, well, for Iraq's Kurdistan, it is they are enjoying a very specific situation here. The situation is that they are seen as part of the Arab world, and that is why if someone is going to have a problem with Kurdistan, by extension, they will have a problem with the larger area. But if Kurdistan is gone, if it is on its own and has no connections and ties with Iraq and the rest of Arab world, then it's going to be a very delicate situation for the Kurdish authorities. Of course, this is a speculation, because this is something that we do not know exactly how it will be working. However, this is a factor that sits in psychology of this region, and people are referring to that. And with that, I wanted to complete my remarks. Thank you for your tolerance and attention.
Thank you very much. So before we turn the microphone to you, I wanted to ask you if you want to react swiftly, shortly, not the whole list, that we still have time for questions or some comments or sharp comments from the audience.
Well, thank you. Indeed, I just want to make a few points very quickly, that we have adopted an open door policy because we wanted to reach out to the outside world and build proper relations based on trust, based on understanding and mutual benefit with the regional partners and with the international partners. And we have proven to be a factor for stability with the neighboring countries and also within Iraq. Therefore, we are a force of moderation and a force for good, for democracy, for human rights, for the empowerment of women. You talked about internal problems. Yes, we had internal problems, and we will continue to have problems, because this is a democracy in the making. Democracy is not a final destination. It's a continuing process. Yes, we have issues, we have problems, but we believe that we are on the right track with political reform, with financial reform, with administrative and economic reform. We would be able to provide the better future that we are going to. But of course, talking about independent Kurdistan, we have to talk about the emergence or the declaration of the Islamic State as a state, because it was declared. A new state came into being with disregard to the boundaries between Iraq and Syria. So therefore, we have to think about the boundaries in a softer way, that these are not taboo and these are not sacred things that have not to be changed. Because borders have some meaning, but in places they have no meaning and they are irrelevant. You talked about the Shia-Kurdish alliance. We have historically had good relations with the Shia community in Iraq because we were both oppressed under the regime of Saddam Hussein, which represented the Sunni elite. But we have never wanted to have a Kurdish-Shia alliance at the expense of the Sunnis. We were the ones who stressed on the fact that there has to be Kurdish-Shia and Sunni alliance if we wanted Iraq to succeed. These are the three pillars of Iraqi community. Unless they work together, Iraq would not succeed. The security challenge is there, and it will remain to be there unless we work hard in order to destroy them. The economic factor, yes, is there. That's why we have made it clear that we were saying Kurdistan is open for business and Kurdistan is gateway to the rest of Iraq, because we did not disconnect ourselves with the rest of Iraq. We wanted to encourage people to come to Kurdistan and use Kurdistan as a stepping stone to establish themselves, and whenever the security situation in the rest of Iraq allowed, because we saw ourselves as part of the bigger economy. We did not want to live in isolation, and we are not an island. Therefore, we are mindful of these facts. The internal factors, we are aware of that. And as I said, in 1992, when we had elections and elected our parliament, we had two political parties. They had agreed on a power-sharing system, 50-50. Today, in our parliament, there are several political parties, not only a third party, there is a fourth and fifth party. So therefore, everybody in Kurdistan is part of that process, and we are proud of that diversity, because we see it as a source of strength in political terms, but also in national and ethnic terms. On the issue of human rights, I don't believe any country in the world is immune for committing mistakes in this area. But we are determined, working with the Amnesty International, with Human Rights Watch, with the free world, in order to improve our record of human rights. And I believe we are much better than many of the countries around us. I'm not comparing ourselves with Baghdad, because Baghdad has no respect for the human rights, as you go to the prisons and you see what's happening there. The growth of the Islamic parties, unfortunately, during the internal fighting that we had in the early to mid-90s, this was the era, the time where the Islamic parties were able to grow, and also the fact that we live in an area which is all Islamist. By Islamist, I don't mean Muslims. I mean Islamic parties who are Islamizing the societies and using political Islam as a... But we are mindful of that, and we are the only secular part of Iraq that not the Islamic parties are ruling. It's the secular nationalist parties are ruling. And I believe people have realized that the more they continue with political Islam, it would lead to more extremism. Therefore, people are aware of that. The problems between Erbil and Baghdad, these are problems that we will not surrender to Baghdad. If Baghdad wanted us to be part of Iraq, they have to come forward the way London has gone forward towards Scotland, to embrace, to encourage, to attract, not to push and discourage. What Baghdad is doing against us is discouraging us, is pushing us away from Baghdad. Therefore, they have to come forward. It will be over for Baghdad to determine our future. My children do not want to learn Arabic. I want them to speak Arabic. They speak English, they speak Turkish, and they have learned Turkish from TV. I have been encouraging them to be able to speak Arabic. They don't like it, because it reminds them of the stories of suffering. We need generations to pass. It's against our government's instructions, because our government has opened Arabic school, encouraging people to speak Arabic. We are trying to use it, encourage people that we need Arabic language in order to talk to our partners in Baghdad. But it has to be smooth, it has to be normal, because you cannot impose on people, because we were deprived. We were not able to study in our own native language. People don't want it. When something is forceful, people don't like it. It has to be voluntary and willing. Therefore, it is not the case that people don't speak the language. People in Kurdistan speak Kurdish. They speak English. Many people speak English, and those who have visited, many people speak Turkish, speak Persian. Some people speak Arabic. The old generation speak Arabic, but the new generation, they don't speak it. We have a tendency to encourage Arabic language in our curriculum. It's in schools. It's compulsory, Arabic as well as English. But the point is that the willing of the people, we cannot. But of course, Baghdad treats us. You know, I write to the foreign ministry in Baghdad. When I send them correspondences, I have to send them in Arabic. But when I send them in Kurdish, they send it back to me. They say, translate this and send it, otherwise it will be ignored. This is not a proper way Baghdad treats the second language, which is the official language of the country. Look at Canada. The Canadian foreign minister visited Erbil. In every press conference and interview, he was speaking English and French, and I asked him, he said, it's required by law. What about my law and constitution in Baghdad? The foreign ministry tells me if you don't send it translated, it will be ignored. So therefore, we have got issues. We have to change the mentality, the approach, the thinking in Baghdad so that we will become equal and meaningful partners. As for the regional powers, yes, of course, we do understand where do we live. We are not living next to Switzerland or Germany or France or Italy. We live in a neighborhood that it's Turkey, Iran, Syria, and Iraq. We are surrounded, but one point is important. We are not inferior to the Arabs, to the Turks, to the Persians, and we are not superior to them. If they are ready to accept us as equal nations, we have no problem. This is the problem. We are not inferior to any nation. That's what we are asking. We are asking to be existing peacefully next to each other, respecting each other, and dealing with each other. But we have made it clear from the day one that we don't interfere in their internal politics. We respect the territorial integrity of their countries. We recognize officially the borders which are there, because we understand that we have become parts of four countries. But at the same time, we sympathize and support of the rights of the Kurdish people in these countries. Therefore, when we talk about our future, we are mindful of the security challenges, of the economic challenges, of the neighborhood that we live in. But when the day comes, when the people decide, there would be no force to stop them from their goals and objectives. Thank you.
So, ladies and gentlemen, the microphone is here. Raise your hands, introduce yourself, and we will collect a few questions, and then we will give the floor for responses.
Konstantin Gebert, journalist, Warsaw. Minister Bakir, the ISIS offensive has dramatically changed the situation, including relations between KRG and its immediate neighbors. Peshmerga commanders have been very vocal in denouncing Sunni Arab tribes for their betrayal and harboring of ISIS militants, whereas Sunni Arab refugees say that they are treated with absolute mistrust when they reach Kurdish-controlled territory. A number of Peshmerga commanders have been arrested for alleged incompetence in the battle against ISIS, and their fate is not known to date. And finally, we've got very conflicting reports from Kobani. Sources in Erbil say that weapons shipments had been sent to Kobani to help it defend itself against ISIS in mid-September. Kobani says no weapons have been received. Could you clarify those issues?
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I am Hossam Ali. I am the president of the Liberal Youth Party in Egypt. I'm here in a coincidence attending a training, and I found it very important to attend this important seminar and speak to you, Mr. Falah. My question is, as an Egyptian, and what is your vision and your thinking required from Egypt and the Arab League? As till now, you're still part of the Arab world. And in the future plans, it looks like that it goes to some other positions. In this case, what do you think the efforts can be done by the Egyptian government and also the Arab League position? Thank you.
Thank you. One more question. Please.
Thank you very much, Veronika Kukinova from the MFA. Thank you for a very interesting speech, talk, lecture. I want to develop what you said about the moving borders or borders that are not as they used to be. Do you have a special policy for dealing, cooperating with Kurdish minorities in neighboring countries, maybe to help them economically and in particular in Syria to help them even survive? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I wanted also to expand on that last question of how is the situation in Kobani or inside Turkey and the shakiness of that, how it's affecting back the debate and discussion in Erbil? Because there are the people somehow reflect it, and you must reflect it, and what is going on in Turkey regarding the Turkish Kurds and the situation in Syria, it has its, no matter if someone wants it or not, has its effects. So what is the dynamics of that and how it can spin out of control, let's say?
Well, going to the first question about the Sunni Arab tribes and what happened in early August. Indeed, many people ask us about the question, why Peshmergas at the beginning in early August until the 6th and 7th have suffered some loss of territory and retreated in certain areas, especially the tragedies that happened for the Yazidi Kurds, in the Nineveh Plain for the Christians and the Shabak. First, the nature of ISIS was different from the other wars that the Peshmergas have been in. Peshmerga is a mountainous force. It's like a light infantry troop. They have been in the mountains fighting a guerrilla type of war or a partisan war. They have to deal with an enemy with a new tactic. They have used the strategy of fear even before reaching a place by beheading people and putting that on the social media, in the media, smiling at carrying heads of people. That created an image of brutality and savagery. Second, the types of weapons that they had, and also the Peshmergas had the light and outdated weapons. And, of course, the experience of the Peshmergas dealing with conventional armies and frontal war in dealing with new tactics of hit and run in different places. The front line that we have with ISIS is 1,035 kilometers long. And that line in the past was protected by 6 Iraqi army unit divisions, and prior to end of 2011, 1 US division was there, in addition to the Peshmergas. So from June onward, the Peshmerga forces were the only forces who were to provide security for that. Therefore, it was a heavy burden on the Peshmergas with their light weaponry. Second, we are not claiming that all of the Sunni Arabs were part of ISIS or were supportive of ISIS. Look at the people who are in Kurdistan today. We have large numbers of Sunni Arabs who are finding refuge in Kurdistan and enjoying the safety and security. Therefore, when there were some voices that we have to ask the Arabs in Kurdistan leave, immediately the president and the prime minister came out publicly say Kurdistan will remain to be open for all those who have fled violence, and we have never allowed our people to react in such a way. We are proud of that tolerance, and we will. But of course, there were some Arab tribes who remained in the areas, and they have betrayed their next-door neighbors, the Yazidis, the Christians, and the Shabak. And indeed, they attacked them, they looted their houses, and they raped their women. And they facilitated and participated with ISIS in committing the crimes. Therefore, those who did that, they would be treated and dealt with the same ways as ISIS. There is no question about that, because they were part of the fighting force. They were the ones who did it. And now when we are taking back territory, these people have left, because some of those Arabs who were living there are in Kurdistan, those who did not approve the policies of ISIS, but those who stayed with ISIS, joined them, is a different question. As for Kobani and our position, we are supporting them. And if there is anything that we can do to support, we will do it. But geography is the obstacle. We have no route, no corridor, and that's why we have been calling upon Turkey to open a corridor, even if they themselves do not support or send assistance. Let the Kurdish young people who are ready to go and defend Kobani. Because, as I said, in Kurdistan, in Iraq, we have got the Kurdish Peshmerga forces who are the boots on the ground, the reliable partner. In Syria, the Kurds are also the partner. Therefore, Kurds can also play an important role in being the force on the ground to defeat ISIS. As far as Egypt is concerned, of course, we look to Egypt as an important country, and there has been historic ties between Kurdistan and Egypt. And the first Kurdish newspaper under the name of Kurdistan was published in Egypt. So, therefore, we have got this long-time standing relationship. We were expecting more from the Arab League. I'm sorry, Mr. Secretary General. We were expecting more from the Arab League to come forward. We are a community living there. Okay, we are part of Iraq, we have no problem. We are Kurds and non-Arabs. In order to satisfy our expectations, we were under dual sanctions regime, one from Saddam Hussein regime and one from the international community at that time. After the fall of the regime, the Arab League and the other institutions of Arab League have got a lot of development programs. They have carried out a lot of surveys in issues related to women, to children, to development, to economy. You could have included us in these programs. This is why we need interaction. We don't need to be dealt with as if you don't know anything about us and you don't want to deal with us. Come and deal with us. We have been knocking at doors, but there has been limited responses. What we need is that, for example, we wanted to have a KRG representation based in Cairo. So far, there has been party politics representative, but we want, in addition to party representative, to have a government representative so that we can develop political ties, economic ties, cultural ties. For learning Arabic language, we have been approaching Egypt, we've been approaching Jordan, we've been approaching other countries to give scholarships to people to go from Kurdistan to study in your universities. They know about your culture, your history, your language, and they learn the Arabic language. Therefore, there are means and ways that we can cooperate with each other. So not only political, it could be economic, it could be cultural and educational. We were proud that Egypt decided to open a consulate in Erbil, and you were among the first Arab countries who came there. Today we have got 5 Arab countries: Egypt, Jordan, Palestine, Emirates, and Kuwait. So, but we need more. For all those Arab countries who have got diplomatic presence in Baghdad, we need it. Part of the problem Iraq suffered from was the absence of the Arab presence in Baghdad. When you leave Iraq alone, then others will come in to fill in the vacuum. Therefore, Iraq should have been embraced by the Arab countries because still some of them do not have embassies in Baghdad. Therefore, don't blame Iraq for what the path that it has been through. The Arab countries should have come forward towards Iraq as a whole, but also towards Kurdistan. Now we enjoy good economic ties with Emirates. They have offered us a lot of courses. They have offered us a lot of opportunities. They have encouraged their companies to come and invest. Jordan, the same thing. Egypt, the consul has been very active in promoting economic ties and commercial ties. But we need more than that. As for the borders and the Kurdish people who live in other countries, of course, when we talk about the borders, these borders are there on paper, but they are also there on the ground because there are military forces on both sides to protect it. But they could be turned into meaningless when we can have economic integration programs, when we can have economic cooperation, when we can do things that would benefit both sides. Therefore, we are trying with these governments in order to have good neighborly relations based on respect, understanding, non-interference, but also good economic cooperation. We believe that people in Turkey, people in Iran and Syria will benefit from good economic cooperation, although the Syrian situation right now is not such. But we have made it clear with these governments that our relations with these governments will not be at the expense of the Kurdish people in these countries. We want this government to understand that the Kurds are there, they have their rights, we support their rights, but it's for them and the Kurds to reach an agreement through peaceful means. And we reject violence and we reject military solution because we don't believe it helps, especially now with the issues of violence, it would go a different approach. As far as the situation in Kobane is concerned, indeed the people who are fighting there have proven to be very brave, resisting and fighting to the last minute in order to defeat ISIS. They need respect and appreciation, but also support in terms of weapons, ammunition, and humanitarian assistance for the people. We are with them, but President Barzani was on the record addressing the issue with in the program of frankness with Zine Yazci on Sky News Arabia, when said that had we had Air Force, we would have airlifted assistance to Kobani, because we have to prove to the ISIS that we are together. We cannot ask for something in Iraq and leave it to go down in Syria. Therefore, ISIS is a threat. If there is any country who thinks that they are immune for the ISIS threat, they are mistaken, and especially those who live in the neighborhood.
Just one question. You mentioned that you are asking for the Arab nations to establish scholarships for the Kurdish students to go over. Do you have similar programs versus Arabs? Maybe it could be a good gesture of goodwill to establish, you know, scholarships for the Arab students to come to Kurdistan.
Yes, indeed. The Palestinians asked us, and we have offered them some scholarships, and I believe it's about 50 students.
Thank you. We have almost exhausted our time, but if there is one more question, like, we could take it, please.
Thank you. I'm Petr Kubalek from Radio Free Iraq, and being a native speaker of Czech, I also write in my Czech language on Kurdish issues. And actually, my boss Sergei Danilochkin has posed a question that I was willing to pose. On exactly on support of Kurdish studies abroad, not just scholarships, any scholarships, but if Kurdistan Regional Government plans to promote somehow the Kurdish academic studies and research in, let's say, the history and culture of Kurdistan for young researchers, and also similarly to this, some activities in raising the awareness on Kurdish issues, because Arbil not only accommodates consulates of various countries, it also accommodates a branch of British Council or the Goethe Institute or the French Institute. So are there any plans to establish something like a Kurdistan Institute with branches in London or Berlin or Paris? Because also curious or interestingly, this gap has been somewhat filled by Kurdish institutions called Kurdish institutes in some European capitals, but some of these are linked to the PKK, the Kurdistan Workers' Party. So I think it may be a doubled motivation for the Kurdistan Regional Government to enter this field and promote some awareness-raising institutions. Thank you.
Well, as far as support for Kurdish studies or Kurdish research, indeed, we are very ambitious in our plans and thinking for the future, but we have to be mindful of our own budget. When we are suffering from not being able to pay the salaries of the Peshmerga who are fighting ISIS since August, and we have not paid the salaries of civil servants and teachers in Kurdistan, it would be very difficult for us to think about funding such project. But this is not a problem of this year. We have done certain things here and there. In the United States, we have done certain programs. In the UK, we did a program with the Exeter University. Now we are planning to do something with SOAS. But these are limited. We will do them when we have proper budgets and we can have a proper plan when we finish with dealing with the threat of ISIS and we are on the proper path of developing our ties. But one part of our policy has been to encourage the KRG representation offices. Today we have got 14 KRG representations in Washington, in London, in Paris, in Berlin, and some other European countries, and Iran. So therefore, we would like to expand that to include some Arab countries to accept the KRG representative to be established there. That would be a way in order to expand these relations. Yes, we are mindful of the, or we are aware of the Kurdish Institute in Paris and the Washington Kurdish Institute. These are not enough. We have to do more in order to encourage the Kurdish diaspora, those who are living there, in order to initiate certain things, because our capacity and our budget is limited. We will not be able to fund such programs. We want the communities abroad in order to take initiatives in order to play their role in promoting our case in Kurdistan. But we've always wanted countries to have presence in Kurdistan, to have cultural institutions, the British Council, the French Institute, and Goethe Institute, they are there. But we have been open even in terms of the private sector, encouraging universities and schools. We have got Turkish language school, Arabic language school, English language, French, and German language schools in Kurdistan, in addition to two American universities, one in Sleimania, which has been functioning, and the other in Duhok, which will be starting this academic year. We are open and we want to be active with the outside world, with the Arab world and with others, but alone we cannot do it. That has to be reciprocated and we have to have partners in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Don't forget about your KRG representation in Prague. As I can't speak on behalf of government anymore. There are others in the audience who can, but I think that from Prague I can easily state that we do see KRG as a really stabilizing factor, stabilizing element of the whole area. We wish that it will remain to be. We wish that it will not be the only one or one of the few stabilizing elements in the area, and so we wish to KRG, to Iraq and to the whole region the best, so that it can really lead out of the mess which is there right now, and I think it can be called a mess. As Sasha said in the beginning, and you have it here, next Thursday, the 23rd, we will have a very similar session to similar topic, more dealing with the IS and the military responses to IS, including the jihadist threat to Europe, with the Europeans fighting in Iraq, Syria, so hopefully not that many Czechs, but definitely many, many Europeans. I just read the statistics. It's at least 1,000 Turkish citizens fighting there. So for Turkey, it's a delicate situation, not only regarding the neighborhood and the Kurdish population, but also regarding their own Turkish population. So I would welcome your presence next week. Thank you very much for coming. Of course, I do thank Mr. Minister. I do thank Sergei for having their speeches, answering your questions, debating here. I hope you have not been bored, and I hope you will not be bored next time. Thank you very much for coming.